to see you back again, and we wanted to start tonight by sharing, having you share any experiences that you had reading with your children this past week, either using the strategies or not. We just like to start that way.
Yeah, seriously, not that different. The only difference between now and when I was like in kindergarten is that I live up there.
I knew you were going to talk first. I knew it. Right? I was like, she's going
to
have her hand.
Yeah, I have some things to share. So we were reading Nuffle Bunny the first night I had a chance to put this into practice. And we were using the picture, look at the picture strategy. Not that she knew it, but that's what we were doing. And we got to the page where the washing machine is there, and she got to the word machine. And she started going, match-ine. And I was like, well, Casey, why don't we look at the picture? What do you see in this picture? She's like, laundry. And I was like, well, mommy talks about doing the laundry. What things do I usually put the clothes in? She's like, dryer, the washing machine. And I was like, yay! And like, I had tears in my eyes. So then we got to the next page where she did something similar, and I really had tears in my eyes. And she looks at me and says, mommy, it's okay. She finds Nuffle Bunny. So that was really interesting. And then I also noticed that she was reading, I think it was a different book that we were reading, and she started going, tap, tap, sweep, and she was using her own strategy I didn't teach her that, so she must have learned it in kindergarten. And I said, oh, that's interesting, you're using something that you learned in school. And she said, yeah, but we can do it your way too. I mean, we can do it however you want, whatever works best for you. This isn't for me, this is for you. But I'm like, it is for me. So yeah, we definitely have been using it.
So great way to start the evening, and thanks for sharing. Let's think a little bit about what you just did for your daughter. And you just did something really important when you took her away from a word that's not easily decoded. What did she do for her daughter?
Maybe about comprehension?
Yes, she did.
Was it a guess? I gave her confidence.
You gave her confidence, you gave her permission. Mm-hmm. You gave her permission to get away from just the letters and think about the meaning and the fact that you're encouraging her to use a strategy that maybe she feels, you know, and we use the word cheating carefully, is cheating. You'll see, and I know Lauren talks about this so well, where you can actually, if you do that wait time and you start seeing her look when she gets stuck on her own once you're prompting her, you'll see the eyes going back and forth to the text to see if there's any context there that's going to help them, any picture there that's going to help them. And it's fascinating to just be that person. So you'll see that developing now that you've given her permission to use that strategy when she's reading with you. You'll find that you can prompt less and less, and that she'll just start using it on her own. So.
That was a great example where the sounded out doesn't work.
Yeah.
Because here she's applying the correct sounds to the letters, but she didn't have the CH as the digraph. I mean, those are things that will come later. So if she continues with that, just the sense of knowing it doesn't make sense, I don't know what this is, I'm not getting it, that's defeating as you're reading. So there, when you provided those supports without telling her the word itself, you led her there, and she felt success for finding that on her own. And I just love how she thought you were crying about the story. So she knew she was doing a great job reading for you to have such emotion. You know?
Yeah.
Right?
That's wonderful.
And she actually did. She did apply the rule properly, didn't she?
She did.
Good
right?
job. Thanks. So, other experiences you had reading with your children over this past week?
Yes.
My Mrs. Holman's class, they send a poetry journal home every weekend, and it usually is a multi-hour event of her reading it. I usually end up in timeout. My husband has to go. And so prior to last Monday, my mode was to correct in the moment. Like if the word was wrong or she, you know, I was kind of always.
You were right there.
I was right there. And so I stopped doing that. And there were a couple. So first of all, I noticed she went much quicker I think since I wasn't interrupting her. And there were a number of times where she, I can't remember the exact details, but there was a couple M words. And she got the first one right, but then it was a different word in the second sentence. And she reverted to the first word, but she kind of hesitated. And I let her keep going. And then I think she realized the sentence didn't make sense. And she self-corrected, went back, and started over again. And so it went from a multi-hour, incredibly frustrating event to a quick, really very successful. Yeah.
And we'll come back to that because we have a prompt when those kinds of things happen that we're going to talk about tonight.
So mine is not with one of my kids. My husband noticed me using tactics.
On him?
No. So my oldest wasn't with me reading. I was reading with my 3.5-year-old. And I don't often ask a lot of questions about the picture. I just kind of, it's late and just want to get through the book. And the poor little guy always wants to ask questions. And I'm like, we'll get to do that at the end. And so this time I like slowed down and like asked him what he saw in the pictures. And he actually like sat and listened and didn't ask a lot of questions actually, because I asked him questions first and let him tell me about the pictures. So my husband was sitting behind us. He goes, did you learn this in your class?
I said, yes, and pay attention.
So it was a much, like, I felt like I tried to take a breather and not put so much focus on the time it was for bed and, like, what I had to do later that night and, like, slow down my brain. My 3.5-year-old's not reading. Like, I'm not.
But they're enjoying the story and the exchange together.
Yeah. Yeah. So giving him all the tools, the beginning reading tools, so important. The background, the vocabulary, the context, and encouraging his curiosity. So,
and to sit and attend to a story and engage in that conversation, you know the attention span of our little ones. They're not always that long. So the fact that when you're reading, you're helping build and practice attention. So it's okay that they're not reading, they're listening and building that comprehension, the vocabulary, and they're having a nice exchange with you in a non-stressful, shoddy time moment. It's great.
Yeah. Just being aware and practicing those strategies, I felt really good because I could tell the teachers are doing that. This is just me because I was a teacher, but I felt like that was happening in the classrooms. I just got that feeling after being aware of it.
Yeah.
So that was very cool to me. I can tell they're doing that in class. So it was kind of natural for Emma, and I was like, they must be doing this.
You're doing the best you can do, right? And you want to help your kids in any way you can, and you need some tools. And you're a former teacher, so.
Right, and it's just cool because you can tell that their teachers are doing, you know, when you just slow down, you're aware of it, you can tell they've been used to it, so it made me feel good that they were doing that.
Is our teacher here tonight?
Not tonight.
No. Okay. Any others before I share mine? Yes.
Well, I picked up two of the books that were recommended, and I think I have a 4.5-year-old, she's kind of a pre-reader, but we love, love, love reading, and I think we were kind of not even thinking about her comprehending the books because we're thinking she's not reading. Mm. So we tend to, like, pick books that we loved when we were kids, and I don't think they're age-appropriate. I hadn't thought about it.
Sure.
So I picked up Frederick and Press Here, and they were both from Mrs. Crawford's list, and I let her hold the book, especially for Press Here, because it's like an interactive book. She's always engaged, but she brought it down to breakfast the next morning after we read it. She had Dad read it with her over breakfast. We read it again before she went to school. Just the act of her holding it, I found it was really moving. I found the whole thing very, she's engaged already, but she got it, and then there was no context for that because the pictures were, it's just about like pressing different dots in the book. But for Frederick, I had her talk about the pictures, and she was also less kind of like stimulated because I was asking her rather than her jumping in to ask the questions and talking about like, well, which one is Frederick? And she was like, he's the one who's snoozing.
Wow.
And I like, never would have thought that she would have even known which one Frederick was.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was, I just found it very cool. I thought it was really good.
So you're really empowering your kids and giving them some really important messages. because the obviously the teacher has huge influence, but not the influence that you have. You know, that they want to please you, so they want to do what you want them to do, and so you're empowering them in such important ways.
Yes, I used your line, the like, that's what a good reader does.
Great.
I thought he was going to implode. That it was like he actually had to hide under the cover because it was like he was like so excited and he was a little embarrassed.
Yes,
and,
like, yes. Thing.
But it was unbelievable.
My mom thinks I'm a good reader.
It was crazy. Yeah.
Good. We're going to give you some more of those tonight. So thank you for all of that. I have tears in my eyes. The boy in the drawer. Do you remember me telling you last time about how my daughter had memorized this story? And so Lauren has the entire Robert Munch collection
up here.
But I wanted to share this with you as just an example of when you have books on tape and your kids listen to them over and over again, how helpful it is to then teach storyline. So the story that she had listened to over and over again with Robert Munch narrating sounded like this. When Shelley went into her room, there were socks on the floor, socks on the bed, socks on the dresser, socks on the wall, and socks everywhere. Yikes, said Shelley. What a mess. So that's Robert Munch. Those were the intonation that he used. And she had heard it so many times that, guess what? She knew it was time to turn the page. Because Robert Munch says, what a mess. And then the story goes on. So she learned storyline by listening over and over again. She had memorized the cadence and the words from listening to him. And so this was the point was, when they want that same story read over and over and over and over again, there is a purpose to it. And so I just wanted to share that because I was so excited that you had it. So tonight we're going to talk about encouragement, and it goes without saying because you all are doing it. We're going to give you some specific ideas about and some things that you can practice saying tonight. We're going to start with that. So, would you want to start?
Sure. So, already you give your child encouragement for things they do in life. They're picking up their clothes, they're remembering to empty their backpack, they're following through on their daily activities. But when it comes to reading, instead of supplying the word or before when you're saying, telling them to sound it out, talking about, wow, that's what a good reader does, or scaffolding, you're helping someone get to the answer, the problem, without specifically telling them to that. And it's a little restraint on your part because so often you want to jump right in there and you just want to do it for them. But if they're not problem solving or going through the process, it's just going to take a little longer to finally get in there and own that strategy. So things that, when you think about how your child learns to read, we talked a little bit about this last week, how they learn to talk. They had the babbling, the echolele. You had your baby talk with them, and then you used full sentences, and you encouraged that. And you modeled. You modeled how to speak with conversations, the tone of your voice, when you really meant something. That's what it's like with reading. When you look at how they'll hear you, the cadence, the flow of a story. When print is in really large letters, they're going to realize your voice gets really loud, or sometimes the print goes up and down on a page, and your voice might follow that too. So while they would not be able to read that on their own, they'll start to notice that when words go a certain way, your voice changes. So that there must be a connection there for that. And learning to read is hard work. It's a code in our language. When you look at the sounds our letters make, what sounds they make when they're put together with other letters, things that are rule breakers, it really is a challenging code. Not everyone will crack that code at the same time, just as children don't talk at the same time, they don't walk at the same time. Some of them skip some phases and really scooch and all of a sudden run. They didn't quite have that wobbling stage. Each reader will develop differently as well. So what's important is to help support all of those areas. We'll talk tonight about poetry. When you think of the rhymes, the nursery rhymes, the repetition, those are important steps. It's wonderful to think back to the classics that you loved as a child, but we don't want to miss those precursors, if you will, that help lay the foundation, and that is phonemic awareness. We'll talk a little bit about that. Phonemic awareness, it's not phonics. Phonics is when you have print and you're looking at letters and you're making a connection. Phonemic awareness is all oral. You don't have to see any letters, you don't have to see any words. You can make up rhymes. Down by the bay, you know that one? you can always make up new ones before you go to bed. Sometimes instead of reading a book, you might make up new rhymes. Where does where the watermelons grow? I found a snake. What's the snake going to do? Oh, he's going to rake. How silly that is. But for them to generate rhymes, play with language, so you, that's another way to build that phonemic awareness. When you're in the car, Kathy talked about books on tape. You can have books in the car, and children can be listening on the CD, listening on your iPod or whatnot, and following along and reading in the back seat to you. And we're all in cars a lot these days. There are so many books, too, that are written to songs. You know, Skip to My Lou. Do you know the Skip, Lou, Lou's? So here's a wonderful story, and you've got illustrations. You can talk about the pictures, all the crazy things that are going on. So children might need to hear a little bit. They might not readily know Skip to My Lou. There's a little song, you know, if any of you want to sing or play any instruments. But as you read it with your voice, you're going to have a sing-song phrase to your singing, to your reading. You know, cats in the buttermilk, two by two. So you can change your voice as you go along. What does two by two mean? Oh, look it, there they are, two by two. Pigs in the parlor, what'll I do? A parlor. That's a great vocabulary word, because you know what? That's not a word that we use as much today as perhaps our grandparents used, but what a great word. Do you think you have a parlor in your house? But again, reading through it, not necessarily stopping on each page to point that out. There are so many other songs, you know, there are the wheels on the bus that you all know. You can find variations here. The seals on the bus. So we know the wheels on the bus. They're going to do it. They're going to do the same things that we know with the wipers and the horn. I don't know, is that something we would see, seals on the bus? And then as you are singing here, you can see those are all in capital letters, so you've got to change your voice. Children love it, and you will see them change their voice. The tiger on the bus goes roar, roar, roar. You know, and then everybody's roar, roar, roaring, and your child can join in and roar with you. But this is sort of a fun, safe way to read because it's a song. They're not really reading. For some of those reluctant readers that at home you're trying to read and decode each one.
I just had to point something out on this one. So for your four-year-old,
yes.
Yeah, so what this lends itself beautifully to is that whole idea of tracking the print. It lends itself beautifully because it goes up and across and the words are separated not in a straight line. Mm-hmm. So if you're trying to not teach, but if your child is learning about that concept of word, that there's a space between each word and that word means something, you've already given them the roar, roar, roar. You could have them finger track and say the word each time. Roar, 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 roar. So that's another really wonderful pointing along as you say the word helps really reinforce. So that's
because otherwise they'd be roaring forever.
You would,
you know. So if you can. So here we go. Each time there's word, each time we point, we're going to say that sound.
Yeah.
Which they don't necessarily have that on their own, that one-to-one correspondence. But you pointing and sort of, you know, waiting for them, that lets them know and lets them know when we're done. And you do that many times, and you'll see that they will be able to start to point and do that with them. So the joy of reading is something else you want to promote. When you talked about the poetry journals, we don't send those home to make your weekends miserable. So you were doing a lot of work with those poetry journals. No, you were, because you wanted that journal to be, you know, just right. Exactly. But you could see when you took a step back, gave some of that encouragement, what a much greater experience that was, an enjoyable experience. And it sounds like your child felt really proud. You felt proud because you saw your child self-correct. But what's tricky is, as parents, you always want to catch your child, but sometimes you need to let them make a mistake to see that it is a mistake and try to fix it. If a child went on and didn't correct anything, I would surely say, do you know what? This is what I heard. Let me see if that makes sense. And then they might say, you know what? It doesn't. And then you can problem solve together. But it's nice to provide that time for them to sort of exercise and practice. That's how children will get better at anything. When you think of sports, when you think of other activities, is to practice. And they need opportunities to practice reading. When you first get on the soccer field, you don't get a goal every time. You miss the net a lot. So when you're reading, there are going to be times that you try something and it doesn't work, but we're that supportive coach that will prompt them along. And always remain loving and supportive, which is hard when children are reading, become frustrated, and sometimes you see a little monster. You know, that's not how you do it. I know what I'm doing. So you know what? Then it's time to take a break and maybe change what you're reading. All right, you know what? And it's okay if you don't finish that book right then and there. You know what? Maybe would you like to sing a song? Would you like to choose the book? Because if a child or you are just, you know, you had a busy day, you need a break, it's probably not the best time to read, because children just pick up on your tone, your body language. They'll know that your mind's thinking, oh, okay, great. That's where you are. That's the page. Wonderful. They'll know that you're not there. And same, you know when your child's not there. So if you need to stop something mid-book, go right ahead, and maybe you'll come back to it, or maybe you'll opt for another story at another time there, because the key is for that enjoyable love of learning. And children have such busy days, they're exhausted when they come home to you, and you're exhausted as well. So how great is it to help facilitate that nice area on the couch, in the bedroom, a nice little nook without the TV, where you just focus on each other for a bit.
So with all of that said, I want to go back to the machine, Shine.
That giant
example, because we also, although we want kids to problem solve, the next page talks about prompts. So we also don't want them to struggle, or if you see them going down the wrong road, like in this case, what are some prompts besides, you know, let's look at the picture that we can use that can encourage our children to problem solve without giving them the answer? And so these are just some examples. So when you see them do something, you can use that one. Good for you. I like the way you did whatever they did. So I like the way you went back and self-corrected. Or I like the way you thought about that didn't make sense and you went back and took another look. So you're reinforcing the strategy that you see them applying. So in this case, she was trying to apply her phonic skills. Good for you. I see that you tried to use your rules and it didn't work. You know what? They don't always work. Why don't we look at the picture? Right? So you reinforce what you saw them doing and give them a prompt to lead them in another direction. This is a good one. And you can just keep these right beside wherever you're reading and check them out. That was a good try, right? So you're acknowledging that that was a good try. They know they made a mistake, so we're not pretending that they didn't. They know it was wrong. So you give them the prompt. That was a good try. Yes, that word would make sense there. But it starts with, we modeled it a bit last time, and now we're giving you the language. That makes sense, so you chose a word that makes sense. Let's say they chose the word dog, and the word is puppy. Okay, so it would have made sense there. There's a picture of a dog, you know, it fits into the context, but what would you expect to see at the beginning of dog? And then they'll probably self-correct. They'll go, puppy. Now, they solved it, you just prompted them. And they're going to feel really good about that. So that's another one.
Sure. And when you pointed out when she looked at the picture, I saw that you looked at the picture. You helped facilitate and have her use that resource. Sometimes children, even in kindergarten, they need reminders to go there because they are kindergartners. You know, they know everything now. They're in school. They can drive. You know, they just feel so confident that it's okay to go back and use the pictures. And we do work on that. During the day, but at home, they might just be so used to one way of trying to identify the words that they need that prompting to go look at the picture, and you can say, I noticed your eyes went there. That was wonderful. That's a great strategy. And you can use the word strategy. Mm-hmm. They're familiar with hearing that word at school, and they just, you know, they'll just feel so proud because they were using one of those strategies here. When children are going, sometimes you'll notice when children do make a self-correction, they will return to the beginning of the sentence to reread the entire sentence. That's great, they're building their fluency. So before when they read it, it might have been a little choppy, a little word by word, because their eyes were looking ahead and they knew they were coming to a word they didn't know. And as it got closer, the words might have gotten a little bit more choppier. So when they finally identified that word and read it, they'll return and they'll read the entire sentence. You can say, wow, that was wonderful that you figured out that word. That was great problem solving. And you reread. That was, you know, it sounded wonderful. Just the way we talk, it was fluent. And children are hearing that word fluent. So you can use that as well. That means it sounds like when we talk. And just that one that you mentioned that was just so, you know, proud at home. That's a strategy that good readers do. You know, wonderful, I'm so proud of you. Reinforce that with them. It just gives them that much more confidence to continue and carry on, because they're going to encounter other words that are difficult for them in the future. So having that confidence to attack those words, whether it's pictures, phonics, context clues, it just empowers them to take risks. And children need to take risks, because there will surely be opportunities where they will make a mistake, but knowing that it's okay, we can problem solve, and you'll support them as needed, but you're going to give them that time, will just go that so far for them in terms of their own reading, you know, their own self-thoughts, self-confidence as a reader.
One other good one that's not on the list, and we'll bring some more next time, is what was the tricky part? Right, so they get to the end of a sentence, or they pause, and you can either say, why did you stop? And they'll say, because it didn't make sense, and you'll say, wow, that's fantastic, that's what good readers do. Or they'll say, because I couldn't figure out that word. But they'll know where it is. So having them take you back, so you're not jumping in, right, as you said, but let them go and then bring them back. Where was the tricky part? There was a tricky part for you. And again, that feel, it makes them feel very empowered that it's okay not to get every single word, and I don't have to pretend that, oh, I hope she doesn't notice. Let's just flip through this one. But instead, bring them right back. You know, there was a tricky part there, and they're going to know exactly where it was. So, any questions on any of that? We're throwing a lot at you. So we're going to jump right into tonight's stars. And the first star that Lauren has already alluded to is using poetry. So she gave you a couple of great ideas about
poetry. So I don't think there's a star for the poetry. So
no, sorry,
we'll just chat.
Sorry, we didn't have one, but it's so important. So Laura pointed out an important piece, which is poems can be poems that are sung that children are very, very familiar with. And so having even one of either a book from the library or a song that they love that you type out in large font, one page, right, one line per page that they can illustrate, oh my goodness, it's so powerful. Particularly when they're not reading yet, right, because then they can feel really empowered, they can start tracking print. They know when that sentence ends that it's time to turn the page, and they can start using their finger. We really encourage finger pointing. They can track with their finger, go ahead.
So my 5-year-old hates when I use point to words.
What?
Yeah.
Is there a him point? Don't you?
She won't.
She won't. Okay.
Yeah, okay. She'll be like, that's it.
How about this?
It's hard to get her to read books.
Will she accept not pointing, but maybe an underliner under the entire sentence?
I'll try that.
Yeah,
so you can
use
a ruler.
Colored construction paper.
Okay. Try that to get the line of print. And then try doing something really fun, like that book that we just showed where the font is all over the place. Or Kevin Hankey's, whose words go around and around and around the page. That's another good one to help them track print.
I've got a fun one. Okay, you can cut out part of a fly swatter, you know, so you've got the window, and, you know, that makes it fun. Slap the word, move along. That makes a little window.
Yeah.
So that might be enjoyable. Because just pointing with your finger.
Yeah.
We also took a mini flashlight, and they used the mini flashlight on each word, and that was the way I got her to do it that way.
But why do you think it is?
She's a lot of anxiety, so I think any like anticipation of, she doesn't really like when books are sing-songy or drawn dramatic.
She likes predictable spots.
Very predictable, and so she doesn't like, I don't know.
Then don't use them. You know what, we're going to get to predictable text tonight, and that'll probably be great for her, okay? Mm-hmm. But otherwise, I mean,
like my older daughter loved,
yeah.
We had like every book that she wrote, and she loved them, and we used to sing them all the time, but my youngest is
so
like,
then you know
there's
what,
no worry,
we're going to find other just right books for her. But taking a favorite song like that, illustrating it, and then, I mean, just modeling the rhyming words. So, little child, your wish come true, here I am right next to, and then you let them fill it in, because it's not the familiar words. I'll take you on a magic ride, so come with me, I'll be your, and you point to the G and go G, and they say G. right? So you're having them listen, and they're practicing rhyming, and they're hearing the cadence, and it's just really fun. So poetry that's either in song form or not, I'm going to give you some other examples.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes children love to have a big book. It doesn't mean you have to read the entire big book. Maybe just a poem from the big book. So many of you might be familiar with Shel Silverstein. So poems like that are, you know, very wonderful, quaint. Not everybody likes those bedtime nice little poems. So you can read one about spaghetti. Spaghetti, spaghetti all over the place, up to my elbows, up to my, you know, and your little child would probably like face, all over the carpet and under the chairs, oh, into the hammock and wound around the stairs. You know, this is a great way. And then there's a wonderful picture, someone's drowning in spaghetti. You can have a lot of fun with an art project with some spaghetti out there drawing a picture, right? So poems can, but this is a great way. Sometimes children, you know, poetry, yeah. But I think it's some of what adults instill, because sometimes adults don't like poetry.
Yeah.
Poetry can be fun. Poetry, you know, here's other little poetry book. In this poem, it's about the spice of life. Ketchup, ketchup on my fries. Oh, so pretty to my eyes. On my fingers, on my face, I like ketchup every slice. So, I mean, you can make up poems. The illustrations are great. You can have conversations about them. They don't always have to be so serious in just the short four line, you know, quick rhyming poems. There's just wonderful opportunities for poems.
So even just, you know, including a poem during your read aloud together, you know, having a book of poetry beside the bed, they'll get favorite ones, and they're listening to you. The idea here is now they're listening to you, right? And then they're hearing. So the phonemic awareness that Lauren alluded to is something that we've only known. This is really very exciting, actually, but we've really only known in the past 10 to 12 years in terms of reading instruction how critical well-developed and established phonemic awareness is to children's reading development. To the point where we find students through our assessments now that we know this, who maybe we didn't notice were struggling because they really had those sight words down and they have a highly developed vocabulary. And typically these are students who are quite bright, who all of a sudden in second grade begin struggling with reading. And lo and behold, when we do the assessments, we find out that these children never had developed phonemic awareness, which we're going to explain a bit more. So when they came to those trickier words and having to apply decoding strategies, they couldn't do it because they didn't have the sound symbol connection that phonemic awareness eventually allows us to do. So playing with language, as we know kids love to do, is so important. So something like higgledy-piggledy, higgledy piggledy wiggledy wump. I met a man who caught a mump. With his left cheek lumpy and his right cheek bumpy, higgledy piggledy wiggledy wump. So we're just playing with sounds and language, and they love it. And exposing them to the sounds. So once they've established a connection to the sounds and the idea that there's pauses, you know, for some reason your voice stops, it goes up and down. Then when they are exposed to phonics, they're exposed to the fact that a sound is, a letter represents a sound, they've got the sounds to connect to the letter. Did you want to add to that?
Just the alligator pie, I mean, that's a great book of poetry here, and there's so many that you can, when we get to our next strategy, which maybe we'll transition to read and do, there are so many songs and finger plays and poems that you can act out as well as read. So, Five Little Penguins Slipping on the Ice. So here's a story that you can read. I mean, we have five little monkeys, so many poems with this. So you can read it first, sing it, you know, five little penguins slipping on the ice, one fell down, ouch, that's not nice. But look at how the words change. The mother called the doctor and the doctor said, no more penguins slipping on the ice. And as you read through the book, you'll see the prints getting louder, people are getting a little more frazzled. So after you read it and talk about it, you can surely have the finger play to go with it, and children are then practicing their fluency. They've got the lyrical intonation of the story in the poem. So it's not, doesn't always have to be a book experience with the print in front of you.
Read and do. So this one is, do you know this book? This is one, this is a favorite book of mine. Something from Nothing. And like Jan Brett, this story has another story. So you know Jan Brett's illustrations give predictions in the outside in the illustrations. Well, in this book, it's a story of a little boy, and as he grows, he has a wonderful jacket that his grandfather made, sorry, when he was a baby, his grandfather made him a wonderful blanket. And then the blanket, as he grows, becomes a jacket. But what's happening is, as the grandfather is fashioning this piece of fabric, the scraps are falling through the cracks in the floor. And a little mouse family below is creating things with these scraps. So there are two stories going on simultaneously, the one in the bottom without any words. So, you know, this is a wonderful story to just enjoy together and then absolutely have some kind of activity project afterwards, you know, with fabric, with something that we could do for your doll or, you know, for a favorite stuffed animal out of something that used to be a piece of your clothing. And I think in the end, doesn't it end up being, it goes to a vest and then doesn't it end up being a button in the end? I think in the very end, it ends up being a little button and a handkerchief. So that's a really great read and do.
Another one.
Oh, you go ahead.
Well, and I'll leave these at the back. Another great read and do are recipes. Children love to be in the kitchen with you. So here I have an example of a smoothie. How you read it. You talk about the name of the item you're making, the title of the recipe. That's going to tell us what it is we're making. Next are the ingredients. And use these vocabulary words with children, the ingredients. This is what we need. Let's see if we have all of those items. The measurement, you have math that you can bring in. 1 cup, what does C mean? What does TXP mean? Abbreviations. Not that you're expecting them to read this, but they're seeing the layout of a recipe and you'd be reading and talking about it, sort of narrating as you go. The steps, we need to slice bananas, we need to mix them, talking about that process as you go through. So other things aside from books can be read. Recipes are a great avenue, and most children like this because there's a wonderful end product that tastes so much better because they help make. As well as, not everybody likes to cook, some simple origami. So these are some directions for a lamp, folding the paper. And here, children learn that it's important to follow the steps of directions because if you forget an ingredient, something doesn't quite taste right. If we're going to fold the paper in a different direction, we might not have a lamp. We might have created something else. So these are just some examples of other readings that read and do. You're reading it and then you're going to do something with it. It might be a finger play, it might be a project, or it might be a kitchen food product or a craft.
So they're learning very early on that reading is something we need and something that is useful to us. This is going to move us into still read and do, but also how we can use predictable patterns. So this one's for your daughter. And we see a lot of this. Again, remember last week I said that the books are written and illustrated intentionally to support the reader. Early reading books with patterns are done also very intentionally, and we call them predictable text. So this is a predictable text with a pattern and a read and do. So it just has everything in it, and it's Eric Carle's The Very Busy Spider. And so we start, predictable texts are often like this as well, where the first page is not part of the pattern. It sets the stage, okay? So here's the spider, begins to spin its web. But usually within 2 pages of a predictable text, your child will be able to read it. So, nay, nay, said the horse. Want to go for a ride? The spider didn't answer. She was very busy spinning her web. Next page. Moo, moo, said the cow. Again, we have a picture illustration supporting. We have what the animal says. Want to eat some grass? The spider didn't answer. She was very busy spinning her web. Okay? So we have a story that makes sense. Children can, by the 3rd page, they've got the pattern. They're looking at the picture, they're reading this fluently, the entire thing independently. Bah, bah, bleated the sheep. They might not get bleated, you can help them with that. Want to run in the meadow, they wouldn't get meadow either. The spider didn't answer, she was very busy spinning her web. So that's a predictable text that ends up And by the way, this book is illustrated with a raised, so kids love to trace the web with their finger, but it's raised. So then you can build a spider web, you know, or something, doing something with insects.
You had another predictable text. There's lots of them out there.
Yeah.
It was one of your alphabet books.
Oh, well, let's see. It was good to help identify the word. Follows the pattern of the alphabet. But what's helpful is it's very limited text. So that, what do we have here? It looks like buttons, the B. We're constructing an alphabet. We're building. Some of you might be familiar with the story. What is that mouse doing to the C? Oh, that's carving. So it's some of the vocabulary dying might be tricky. Erases, we've got an eraser there. So the predictability here is the alphabet pattern. They'll know what letter is coming next. They might need help with what's happening in the picture.
So this is one. A little boy planted a carrot seed. Also love this book. His mother said, I'm afraid it won't come up. His father said, I'm afraid it won't come up. His big brother said, it won't come up. So lots of support in this book. Every day the little boy pulled all the weeds around the seed and sprinkled the ground with water, but nothing came up. So you can see it's not quite as predictable as the last one, and nothing came up. I know you're dying to know how this ends. Everyone kept saying it wouldn't come up. Still pulled the weeds. And then one day, a carrot came up. Another rule to children's literature, just as the little boy had known it would. There's another rule to children's literature, and so when you talk about appropriate stories, is that there's always a happy ending. There's adversity, but it never kind of leaves you, so you can always kind of count on that, that there can be problems that are encountered by the characters, but there's always a happy ending in a children's story, so you can be reassured that the carrot was going to come up again. So.
Now, for some predictability, the Robert Munch books always have a pattern, and he writes about things that kids are interested in. Birthday parties, inviting the entire school, losing your tooth, show and tell. So this is a story, and I've always enjoyed reading this to students. Purple, green, and yellow, because what children don't like to color where they shouldn't with markers? And I'll just read you a few pages. And children, when they hear these again, even though the repeating phrase might be a little longer than some of the other books, they get it and they're able to join in. Bridget went to her mother and said, I need coloring markers. All my friends have coloring markers. I mean, kids can relate to this and so can you. They draw wonderful pictures. Mommy, I need some coloring markers. Oh no, said her mother. I've heard about those coloring markers. Kids draw on the walls, they draw on the floor, they draw on themselves. You can't have any coloring markers. So of course you're showing the illustrations or the child's holding as you read here. Well, said Bridget, there are these new coloring markers. They wash off with just water. I can't get into any trouble with coloring markers that wash off with water. Get me some of those. Well, her mother said, all right. So her mother went out and Bridget got 500 washable coloring markers. Bridget went up to her room and drew wonderful pictures. She drew lemons that were yellower than lemons, roses that were redder than roses, and oranges that were oranger than oranges. So it goes on with those. She gets a little bored and she says, I didn't color in the walls, I didn't color here. So mom gets her some more. Next time it's 500 markers that smell. After some time, she's ready for new markers. Then she gets 500 super indelible, never come off till you're dead, maybe even later colored markers. But those are the ones that then she realizes how pretty it is to color her nails, and she gets into trouble. But because the pattern keeps, what's changing is the style of markers, and all of his books follow that repetitious pattern. And there's always something funny at the end. And in here, she colored her bed, but then when it rained, that color came off and the indelible was left. So his books are just great. And for those that were looking for something empowering girls, he has one called The Paperback Princess.
I love that.
That is, it's a different type of princess. She stands up and she's not just all fluff.
I wanted to do that one last night with Casey, because I was looking for books from the list. We have so many of them. I was like, well, let's do The Paperback Princess. And she's like,
Yeah, we've done that one pretty recently, though. I was thinking, is the Grinch Who Stole Christmas on the list? And I was like, oh, it actually is in the holiday section. She's like, yeah, let's do that one. And I was like, oh my God, it's so long. There's so many, like, the word, and the, you know, Dr. Seuss, like, they're going to be words that aren't really words. So I was like, okay, and I started talking. She was like, don't worry. She started setting up pillows for me. I'll make you comfortable. It's going to be a long one.
Okay. Yeah. You know, when you have that on tape, Walter Matthau was the one who was so kind that reads that. He has a great voice for the Grinch. Yes. I mean, when I had it, it was set.
I love that she knows that there's a list.
Right. Oh, yeah. Oh, she's reading the instructions. Like, I can't leave this next to her bed, because then she'll be like, Mommy, aren't you also supposed to tell me that it was a good strategy and that's a good reader's note? Where was that in our discussion? I can't leave stuff around.
Okay, so were you going to add something? I don't know anybody's names, but you.
No, that's cool that there's a book on tape I was talking about.
Okay.
That's right. So chances are it's still somewhere, but
so read and do.
And those books, it doesn't always have to be you. Like, you could enjoy that together. When some, you know, like, just think of Walter Matthau's voice and how great it is. I mean, we can't emulate Walter Matthau's voice. So sometimes it's great.
Erin, I purchased that one on iTunes.
Oh, okay.
iTunes actually has a lot of children's books available. They're not that expensive. What I like about them too is we used to finally take the CD out from the library and put it in, and we'd listen to it over, 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 over again. At night, the kids would fall asleep with these through their monitors. So I would buy them on iTunes and put a couple of stories on a CD and burn it, so at least we'd have a few stories going.
Nice.
That I could be listening to at night.
Yeah,
that's great. Nice. And even when you're in the car to listen to stories, that's great, because you never know what comes on the radio these days. Sometimes it's things in the news, other songs that aren't quite appropriate over the years. So that's great.
I recently found an app on for the iPad, on the iPhone too, but it's Reading Rainbow, and you pay. There's a free portion, but we ended up getting the pay, so both my girls have their own backpack, and they can either choose to read, look at the, you know, pages without, so at least a lot of times we'll just read, or it can be read to you, and again, it has the dynamic voices, but I do notice they do the same ones over and over again, which is fun.
But they're becoming familiar with it, and their eyes are tracking it as they go along, so now you can see there is purpose to that.
And it's neat for them to go, they have like different lands, so they can go to the land of princesses or the land, you know, to pick which book. And mom's not, you know, I know they're all good.
That's good. Except that's great.
Elise was reading one about the Titanic the other day.
Reading Rainbow.
Reading Rainbow.
Reading Rainbow. Reading Rainbow.
There's also another one too called and Juliet, my daughter just told me about it. So at Next Generation, they go to storyline.com and they, and it reads a bunch, it reads to them, and but it like has a dot that goes over the word as well. So she reads along with it. My half-year-old and my family with it at this point, but they can choose different stories all the time. So that was another one that she asked me to how to Google storyline.com, and Rob's like, go find out what that is first before she Googles it.
Right. Sometimes they'll have the dot, or sometimes they'll highlight words. So for children that aren't quite ready to point or don't want to point, their eyes are going the word by word.
So our next strategy is act it out. And so we chose these two, the read and do and the act it out, to give you both tonight, just in terms of having that activity component. And so act it out lends itself clearly to, you know, stories that they're really familiar with, not nursery rhymes, but just fables or Three Bears and those kinds of things. That the kids know the storyline, and what's really good about using that strategy is the retell piece. So you know how last week we talked about you talking about the story really helps kids develop that sense of retell, the characters, what's happening during the story, the kinds of questions that we talked about you doing. So act it out is a good one for storyline, because it really helps with the comprehension, and they can really, if you have more than one, it can be a fun thing to do with several children, acting out a particular story. It could be one of those Robert Munch stories, right? That you can read to kids and act it out. The other way is to do something, you know, that's really familiar, like we're going on a bear hunt. So a game that they're used to playing, but that now all of a sudden it's in a text. So we're going on a bear hunt. We're going to catch a big one. What a beautiful day. We're not scared. Uh-oh, grass. Long, wavy grass. Can't go over it. Can't go under it. Oh no, we gotta go through it. Right, and then you know this, and it just swishy, swashy. So there's lots of great things going on here. We have phonemic awareness going on. We have splish, splash. Oh, there's some squelch, squelch. But we have repetition too, and predictable text. We're going on a bear hunt. We're going to catch a big one. What a beautiful day. We're not scared. So this is another example of you might not, and thank you for leaving all these great examples out for us tonight. You might not have the opportunity to have the actual book, but if it's something that your kids know and it's a little game that you do and you can make it into a text, that's another way of using words in ways that kids are already familiar with the words. They know that rhyme. So if you write it down now, that can be something that they can act out. Did you have another one for that?
I think we had the penguins, some of them, it might not be in a book form. You might have it on a sheet, like a poem or poetry. So many different, around the holidays, they've got the pumpkins, five little pumpkins. You can add that, and literally you can drop and roll out of sight. So it can be a wonderful story that has illustrations, but it can also be a sheet that you find on the internet to print off or to read from your tablet. Mm-hmm. It's okay, because what you're getting here is the lyrical, the songs, you know, adding some motions to it. Kids love to be a part of it, and when they're, whether they have hand motions or their whole body's moving, they just feel that much more connected, right. Especially at the young age with that.
And so this prompt, I had forgotten this, but it also suggests, you know, acting it out with puppets. Actions or puppets can be really fun and really helps with, this is a really good comprehension strategy. So it could be a story that they really like that you've reread several times and now let's act it out, or using the puppets. So those are also good things, good ways of practicing their understanding.
Because as you're swishing the grass, what might that be? Swish and squelch. Those are great vocabulary words you can really get into instead of just stepping.
So what were we going to use for move on? We had something identified.
I have these at the end for some context clues here. Let me see. So I have never take a shark to the dentist. So to move on, I'm going to, you know, read, and I'm going to have trouble with a little bit of a word here, and then move on means I'm just going to move on and just go back, hopefully go back and see if I can figure it out. Never take a to the dentist. Here I've got a picture clue that's going to help me identify shark. Never go shopping for what a centipede. So here the picture clue, it's shoes. Never go shopping for shoes with a centipede. So for the younger children, it would be the pictures that will help them move on. Never play, you know, and you would be reading this for them a bit. Never play, what do you think? With a spider. They'll recognize that. Never play checkers with a spider. And what a great sounding word, checkers. You know, say that word, checkers. Fun stuff, and of course these pictures are just great here. For some other context clues, Silly Sally, and this also has some repetition. Some of you know this. So we've got Silly Sally going to town, walking backwards, upside down. On the way, she met a pig, a silly pig, and they, that looks like pig, they, what are they doing here? So trying to figure out that word dance, that might be a little tricky. Looks like they're having fun, they're moving. You might need to do a little problem solving with that to figure out dance. On the way, she met a, so I've got a context clue dog, that familiar pattern. They played, I might have trouble with that last word. I don't know if they played. So here I'm gonna use the picture again. It would be leapfrog to figure that out. So we've got some good picture clues to figure that out. Let me see, the context clues. Miss Mary Mack. So here's even context clues you can use with the books that are similar to the poems and the songs. Miss Mary Mack. Now, all dressed in black with
down her back, you know, she's got something.
Of course, it's a little hard to see their silver buttons with the book. But sometimes what you can do when you read on, you can figure out what the word is that's giving you difficulty based on the other words in the sentence or the picture clue. When you're using the picture clue, that's your strategy. When you're able to use the other words in the sentence, you would have, that's called a context clue. How is that word being used? An example, when we read last week and I had trouble with the word stairs, I knew they were going up, but up, that didn't match because that word stairs began with S, as my friend pointed out to me, so it couldn't be up, so it was stairs. That would be an example of a context clue there. And we've got the pink refrigerator there, some of our other books.
Right, so we're trying to find a good example of when we might use move on and not use a picture. So they get stuck on a word, and you can prompt them. You can say, you can either use the words move on, or you can just say, why don't you leave that one alone, and we'll come back and try it again. Because you know from looking at the sentence that the context is going to help.
Okay.
So we're trying to find a good example of that.
Here we go. Okay, so here I'm reading. It knocked over the trash cans and over ran over toes. It twisted the, plugged up the hose. So now I'm going to be, it was the sprinkler there. It plugged up the hose. What does the hose go with? Here it goes with the sprinkler there. So these are a little more advanced for, not necessarily our developing readers here. Here's one. She slapped it and scolded it. So say you're doing a little shared reading. Pinched it and kicked it. And then she took hold of its stem and she it. Okay, a stem. I know a stem goes with the plant. She picked it because you would pick something that has a stem there. So I could use the word stem to help me identify the word picked. Okay.
And here's one. So one day his mother said to him, Joseph, look at your jacket. It's shrunken and small. Doesn't fit you at all. It's time to, and they're going to struggle on the word throw, and there's no picture to support that. So it's a short sentence. It's in the middle of the sentence. I know that by reading to the end, they're going to be able to come back and get that word. So that's where I would use that as an example of move on, a good time to use move on. It's time to, they get stuck, you wait a minute, you give them a few seconds, and then you prompt them. Why don't you move on? You see that there's only two short little words left, it, and they're gonna get out. And then you're going to have them come back and read, then try it again. So it's time to, they're gonna get it, throw it out. So using move on, when there's no picture to support, and when you know that using context will help. Grandpa can fix it, Joseph said. Grandpa took the jacket and turned it round and round. So one day his mother said to him, Joseph, look at your vest. It's spotted with blue and there's something on it too. It's time to throw it out. So, again, there's something, and then they're going to read on it too. So there's glue, and this word is paint, so that's not going to be easy to decode, and there isn't a picture to support me, but I know that glue, and I'm going to finish on it too. If they come back and try that again, there's a good chance they're going to get it, and they're going to feel really that they use context to figure out a word that would have otherwise been very difficult to figure out. No picture, you can't decode paint.
So here's an example, but again, this would be a little shared reading, so the challenging words. They catch a whiff of something sweet. They follow that, and I would tell them fragrant. Scent of, what might, the word is perfume. The fragrance, the sweet smelling of it, that might help you with perfume. Here, nothing in the picture is going to help you. It's what was said, the words, the context that would help you
understand that the fragrance they're talking about is the perfume. This is not something you would expect your developing reader to read, but if you were reading, maybe you would pause here, not expecting a rhyming word, I wonder what that might be. And they might, instead of having them stop, you might stop and build up some of their, you know, picture clues and context clues with that strategy.
Okay, so we've talked about predictable text, we've talked about picture clues, we've talked about interacting with the text by reading and doing, and now we're going to demonstrate nudge, my all-time favorite. So, I'm the chief of child. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. My father stood up, so did all the other grown-ups.
I stood up too, even though I was too little to catch the ball. Once all the jumping and yelling stopped,
my father sat down, and with a big smile, he held in front of me a beautiful white baseball. So what she just did is, I got stuck on grown-ups. She wanted to give me the word right away, because we're doing nudge now. We're not waiting for a few seconds. I nudged it, she picked it right up, kept the fluency going and the meaning. She took that whole next sentence, and then the beginning of the following sentence was the word once. Very difficult word, especially at the beginning of a sentence, in the middle of a sentence.
That's not beginning the story once upon a time.
A little bit different, right. So for her to have nudged it back at the beginning of the sentence, she looked ahead to know a time when I was going to be successful. And the words that she gave it back to me on were, my father sat down. So she saw four words there that she thought reasonably good that I was going to be successful on, nudged it right back. I didn't have to feel, you know, that I'm being tricked. And you can see how calm it was and how enjoyable.
So I didn't nudge at the end of a sentence. I nudged, so we were both following along, and I nudged and she picked it up where I stopped.
All of a sudden, I was no longer sitting with my father. I was standing on the
pitcher's mound, dressed in a Red Sox uniform. One more strike.
And we win, kid, said the skip.
Johnson, that's his last name, the manager, as he handed me the ball and returned to the dugout.
Right, so we keep the meaning. It's really a very calming, reassuring way to read a book with your child that's a little bit above their level. So this is a challenging text for me, but I'm really looking forward to reading it with my parent because I know that they'll help me when I need it, and it's just going to be enjoyable. So what I always suggest is try out the strategies. And now that you've got several, let your child choose. You know, what strategies do you want to use tonight? And maybe they're going to say, and you know what, they're going to want to nudge for a while, and that's okay. It's okay, because sooner or later, they're going to want to get the reading back from you. It's a bit of a test. They're used to you, you know, making them work. So they're going to want to do nudge for a while. But don't forget, you get to nudge it back. And so, it's going back and forth, very supportive, and an opportunity to get through the poems, perhaps. questions about any of the strategies that we talked about tonight? We didn't do a very good job of demonstrating move on, but I think you get the point, that you use it when you can't use pictures, and when you feel that reading the rest of the sentence will give them enough of a clue to go back and have them help. You'll see some examples of
and especially as your child is moving on to more challenging texts, you will see less and less pictures, and what we brought with us tonight was just so heavily supported by illustrations that when your child's beginning some of those early chapter books, even the books that have little paragraphs for them, that's where you'll see that strategy really come into play.
So we're right on schedule. I can't believe it's 8 o'clock already. You are an incredibly attentive group. So it's really a pleasure to do this with you. We like to end at 8 so that you can take out some books and also have an opportunity if you have individual questions for Lauren or I, or just for you to visit with each other.
Or some of the books. A lot of these books that were pulled today are available to check out. I'd like to work with your child account. Please get some refreshments.
yes, thanks to the HPTA for providing coffee, water, and treats. It's wonderful.
So. And to HCAM.
Yes, thank you.